Welcome to Syndicated Nightmares, where each week we'll take a deep dive into an episode of Freddy's Nightmares based on the Nightmare on Elm Street films. Today we are covering It's a Miserable Life that aired October 16th, 1988, written by Michael De Luca and directed by Tom McLoughlin. Okay, so how did you like this episode?
So I guess this was the first episode that's more anthology series than Freddy centric.
Mm-hmm. We just had the beginning of Freddy, right? Like he was only at the beginning.
Yeah.
Kind of doing his tails front from the current
right.
thing.
Maybe he showed up in a commercial break, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I thought it was fun. This was like the first episode. This was an episode that I watched a long time ago and then just rewatched.
Mm-hmm.
And I enjoyed it more this time than I did the first time.
Okay.
Because I think when I originally watched it, I was, you know, disappointed that the series wasn't just like the movies. And now, like, you know, not expecting it to be anything more than it is. I thought it was fun and creative.
Yeah.
What did you think?
I didn't care for the episode mm-hmm. too much. It was really hard to get through the full 45 minutes, or I guess an hour from mm-hmm. when it, you know, really, really aired. Yeah, I think it was because even though I knew Freddy wasn't in it, I still wanted Freddy to be in it.
Right.
I think that was the whole reason why I was watching it. And I don't know if in 1988 they told viewers, like, hey, if you're here to see Freddy, you're going to be really disappointed. So if you just go into watching the episode knowing that, maybe it's a little bit better, but...
Mm-hmm.
I wanted Freddy and I was disappointed. And so maybe I just had a bad attitude the whole time
right.
because I wasn't getting what I wanted. So the storyline of this episode is Freddy goes after a Springwood teenager who stopped working at a burger joint owned by his father. And the episode opens on the diner. It's called Beefy Boy. And I thought, what a missed opportunity for them not to take place at the Crave Inn.
Oh my God, I didn't even think about that.
Yeah, as soon as it like showed the counter and I was like, well, Alice should be working there right now.
Right.
What's going on? Yeah.
Yeah, maybe that's why they didn't have any customers, because the Crave Inn is like the popular place and Beefy Boy is a bit passe and nobody goes there anymore.
Yeah. That's genius. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So maybe the Craven's like right across the street. Although they did say that this burger joint is in a bad part of town.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I didn't get the idea that the Craven was in a bad part of town, because Alice was able to, you know, just run around and around and around
right.
and nothing happened to her. She wasn't
exactly.
mugged or anything.
Yeah. She sneaks out her window at night and runs down there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like mm-hmm. totally fine. That's, you know, the hick town of Springwood for you.
Exactly. And so our main character in this is, or at least for the first half of the episode, is John Cameron Mitchell, who's best known for Hedwig and the Angry Inch in one of his early roles. So he's in high school because he says he's got to fill out his college applications,
mm-hmm.
but I guess it would have to be 18 if he's there working all night, right?
Yeah.
You couldn't have a minor working all night.
Yeah, that's something I didn't notice while watching it. But now that you bring it up, that's a really good point. But he is working for his dad. So maybe he's like covered under some like parental child labor thing. I don't know.
Yeah.
So, well, as we learned in the first episode, No More Mr. Nice Guy, these writers don't really stick to reality. I think they just,
right.
they're just like, why not?
Mm-hmm.
This kid is going to work all night long.
Mm-hmm.
We'll just make him 15 because who cares?
Right. And then his girlfriend, Lar Park-Wilson from mm-hmm. Friday the 13th, part 7, they're talking on the phone and she's like, I'll swing by around 3. It's like when I was
3 a.m.
Right, when I was in high school, I couldn't, you know, hey, I'm going to go visit someone at 3 a.m.
Yeah, that struck me as odd, too. But when I watched it, I thought, oh, well, maybe her parents don't know that she's going to pick him up,
mm-hmm.
you know, and like, so that's why she has to sneak out at 3 o'clock in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
But I just think that her parents would not be okay with that. And, you know, like, she seems like a rather good girl.
Right. Although at the end, we learn the story with her parents. Yeah.
So, I mean, is she like Dylan McKay and,
oh my God,
you know, and doesn't, you know, Jim Walsh just watches over her account and she doesn't have parents that she has to,
I
you know,
love
talk
that
to.
Explanation.
Yeah.
And she's like, yeah, she's like the teen alcoholic who hangs out at the, who's got a, mm-hmm. a room at the hotel. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. What's it called? I can't think of the name. It's not expunged. It's.
Oh, when, it,
when a teenager yeah. is, It's X something. God, I can't remember what that word is.
I'm trying a blank on it too. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah.
All right, it'll pop into one of our heads later.
Yeah. So whatever that is, she has been Dylan
McCade.
Yeah, Dylan McCade. And so she just takes care of herself.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm glad we figured that out.
Okay, yeah. So yeah, I guess it doesn't matter that she leaves at 3 o'clock in the morning because nobody cares about her.
Fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
So he's working at the restaurant and this guy comes in, this, you know, evil biker guy comes in.
Yes.
And yeah, drives in through the drive-thru and shoots him. But I'm just wondering, like, what was that? Is that just what that guy wanted to do? He wanted to show up somewhere and shoot someone?
I'm so glad you brought that up. Because one of my notes was, what was his motive? Mm-hmm. He didn't rob the place. There was no backstory that, like, this kid owed a drug dealer money and that's what he was, you know, being shot for. There was just no explanation as to why this random biker bad guy drove up and shot him in the head and then drove off.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No motive whatsoever. I did like... And even though I knew, okay, it's obviously a horror TV show, so somebody's going to die in it, I did like how they kind of foreshadowed it a little bit in dialogue where the kid says, I'll probably die here, when he was talking to his girlfriend or his dad, one of the two. He was talking to either his girlfriend or his dad. And he was like, I'll probably die here. And I was like, oh, you are. So I'm glad you came to terms with that already.
Yeah. It was, I mean, mm-hmm. I liked that it was kind of predictable that you knew he was like, that he was going to get killed, you mm-hmm. know, being shot in the head. And the whole thing was just, yeah, this dream sequence, like as he's being killed. But I don't want to spoil other movies, but it's been done before. But yes. I liked that. It was predictable, but I liked it. I thought that was neat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I also wrote down, why is this place even open if there's no customers?
That's a good point. Yeah. Cause dad is like, I need you to stay here all night, but nobody's around.
Exactly. Yeah. So, and I kind of like, I felt bad for the dad because that seemed like it was his dream to own his own restaurant and he wanted to provide for his family mm-hmm. and do right by them. But everybody's over at Crave Inn. So, you know, there was no reason for him to be open 24/7.
Yeah, good point. And he's put like his heart and soul into this restaurant and his son is like, you mm-hmm. know, oh, I can do better. I'm going to be out of here. That's going to be hurtful.
And I thought... The writer of this kind of picked up on those adolescent problems. Mm-hmm. And so maybe I'm sure teenagers were the target demographic for this show in 1988. And so that they kind of put in these adolescent problems to connect with the viewers, that he was working late while his friends were out and, you know, he couldn't hang out with his girlfriend. He was learning about responsibility. He had to apply for college and his parents wanted him to go into a career that he didn't want to go into.
Mm-hmm.
And so they weren't very supportive of whatever he wanted to study in college, like arts or something, whatever it was. So I thought that was kind of like what high schoolers really do face, you know, and so that they could kind of connect with the character a little bit.
Yeah. And he feels guilty about wanting to leave his family. And yeah, it worked in a lot of those struggles.
Yeah. So do you remember what his name is?
Brian.
The boy's name is? Brian. Okay. So when Brian is, well, when we know that the gun goes off, but we don't know exactly where the bullet lands, we just assume that he was killed. Because after the commercial break, he wakes up from a nightmare in his bedroom, and he goes downstairs. And it's kind of one of those comical nightmare situations where the mom is just acting real weird and Freddy-like. So, the viewer knows what's going on. Like, oh, they're in a nightmare right now. But Brian didn't know what was going on. But when that happened, at first I thought, oh, maybe they're going to put a spin on it. And it was actually his dad that was working, because maybe Brian was like, F this, I'm not staying late. I'm going to go hang out with Karen. And his dad had a cover. And so because Brian wasn't there working, it was his dad who got shot.
That would have been an interesting twist.
Yeah. And so that's why, his dad wasn't home when he woke up from his nightmare, and his mom was kind of being like aloof to him. Mm-hmm. But no, it was just some crazy nightmare that he was having where he makes out with his mom.
Right.
Awesome.
That was so one thing I noticed, there's a lot of people making out in this episode.
Yes.
The making out with the mom, the nurse and doctor making out.
Mm-hmm.
I think there was another one later. I wrote in my notes, why do people keep making out?
Yes. And that's so funny, because I also wrote in my notes that's hysterical. I wrote in my notes, anytime there's sex, Freddy is involved.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Just for no reason, these people are making out all over the place. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if that's also, no offense to teenage boys, but if that's what they're interested in, because their little hormones are all over the place, was that a ploy to keep them interested in the episode?
But it wasn't sexy making out. It was just...
Yeah, it was creepy making out.
Exactly.
Yeah. I don't know. Well, I think we're going to have to talk to this Michael DeLuca and ask him, what was the point behind all of this?
Right.
Yeah. So, okay. So we don't know the biker's motive.
No.
And
well, one other thing about him working there, he had his high school yearbook with him. And that's it just seemed like if you were in high school and you were going to be sitting somewhere all night, you would bring homework or magazines.
That's a really good point.
Who's going to bring their high school yearbook?
Yeah, that's a really good point. Maybe they just got it that day.
Oh, maybe.
I remember when I was in high school, they were passed out. Mm-hmm. And you for the next week, you followed all the popular kids around and asked them to sign your yearbook. Mm-hmm. Or maybe that was just my experience with it, So maybe they just got it that day, and he was going to have Karen sign his yearbook at 3 a.m.
Oh, perfect.
In the morning, because why not?
Right.
Yeah. Maybe the biker guy was going to sign his yearbook also.
Probably.
What did he have to do at 3 o'clock in the morning?
Right. Besides maybe the biker guy shot him to get to take the yearbook.
Oh, maybe. Maybe there was someone famous in the yearbook.
Yes.
And he mm-hmm. needed it. And so that was his motive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, okay. We have the motive for the biker guy that perhaps it was I don't know, Michael Jordan during that time.
Mm-hmm.
And he traveled back in time to get Michael Jordan's yearbook so he could sell it on eBay and make millions.
Perfect.
Yep. All right.
Glad we figured that out.
We just fixed that plot hole. Don't go stepping in that one, because you won't recover. So, okay. I have in my notes, I have the random makeout sessions, and then the nurse with the hearing impairment.
Does the nurse have a hearing impairment, or does there's a patient with a hearing impairment, and she gets confused and thinks Karen is the one with the hearing impairment?
Yes, that's it. And how culturally insensitive it was for the nurse just to go up there and start screaming into her ear. And it's oh, you have a hearing impairment. That's just how I'm going to talk to you.
And she slams down the bedpan.
Yes. To wake her up. I don't, maybe she needs to take like a sensitivity training course or something, because I don't think that's good bedside manner, whether we're in Springwood Hospital or not.
Right. And there was also the chart for the guy next to her. It said a hopeless basket case. So they're not very sensitive there.
No, not at all. And I don't think that is an actual diagnosis. I'll have to check the DSM-4. So maybe that's in there. I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
But then do you remember the live lobotomy that they were?
Yeah, that it's like a
that they were doing
melon top that they cut off her head.
Yes. Yeah, they just hacked her skull right open, and like her skull just like popped off. You know, they added that sound effect of the pop, and they just handed over the top of her head and gave her a live lobotomy for whatever reason.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's bizarre, because I mean, I think that's the format of a lot of these episodes, that there's a main character in the first half and then it switches to another character for the second half. But the second half of the episode is just Karen, weird things happening to Karen in the hospital.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm not sure, like, is this supposed to be reminiscent of before the bullet kills them? Is this like what they are thinking is going to happen, or like not their life flashing before their eyes, but you know, like kind of what they envision their life would be?
I think in the case of the first guy, I thought it was just this whole, like, you know, nightmare experience that he has in the moment he's getting killed.
Mm-hmm.
They said she just had surface wounds. So I'm not really sure where her, I mean, I was going to say, I'm not really sure where her nightmare came from, but she just, she just watched her boyfriend get killed and then got shot.
That's true. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. So the hospital, and this is where everything in Springwood is named Springwood. Mm. The hospital is Springwood Mercy Hospital. And I think that's kind of contradictory, because mercy is anything but what they give.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they have, I wrote down, when they lift Karen out of bed, it should have been a two-person lift, but instead it's just the one nurse who, you know, picks her up, like the bride and groom, you know, pick up, and how the groom picks up the bride and carries her over the threshold. So he picks her up like that and puts her on the gurney and goes off with her, when I think technically that should have been a two-person lift, and there should have been two nurses, and you're supposed to like pick them up with a blanket, you know, you pick the blanket up underneath them and then hoist them over to the gurney.
So you're saying they did not have a medical consultant on the set?
No, yeah. No, they did not. So, and I think maybe that's where the budget cuts might have come in. You know, they should have had somebody to consult, but it's all right.
Mm-hmm.
So they put her on this gurney to bring her downstairs to the limb bank. Did you catch that?
I think I wrote that in my notes, or that they're saying they were going to cut off her legs and left arm.
Yes. And they took her down the room. The room was called a limb bank. And the surgeon down there was just hacking away at a cadaver's leg, I think, and just sawing it off, and then like threw it over his head to the pile of other limbs that he had going on with him. Mm-hmm. So I don't know what kind of crime he was involved in, you know, like who was picking up these limbs, what they were going to do with them. But Springwood really needs to get their shit together.
Yeah.
Because that town is just going downhill real fast.
Right. And then also, Freddy was in the hospital.
Yes.
Messing with the power.
So, and to the viewer, that makes sense that Freddy is there. But to the characters, how do they know who Freddy is? Because we never hear them talk about it, you know?
Yeah.
And to me, if it doesn't happen on screen, it doesn't happen, like, or it hasn't happened. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, maybe we can assume that everyone in Springwood just knows who Freddy is, but unless they tell me that they know who he is, I don't believe that they do.
That's a good point. But do they reference Freddy, the characters? Or do we?
I don't think that they do.
Okay.
No, so Freddy is just there. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, it's kind of like, well, if you don't reference him, how do I know that you know who he is?
Hmm.
Yeah.
But maybe they don't. Because it seemed like that came in later, that, like, Freddy can only come after you if you know who he is. That was later in the series.
I thought that was a Nightmare 4 thing. Because that's why he needed Kristen to pull Alice into her dream. And then he used Alice as, like, this catalyst to, you know, get to the other.
Yeah, but that kids. Was... I thought it was, like, she was... That's how he found them. They were, you know, because he... got in her dreams and then went after the people she was connected to, but
But then, and it wasn't until Nightmare 6 that he was able just to go from random kid to kid. He didn't really need them to be an Elm Street brat, right?
Yeah, because in 4, before anyone gets killed, Rick is explaining to Dan, like, Freddy Krueger's the town legend, and so he's already well-versed in who Freddy is.
Mm-hmm.
Although I guess Freddy was dormant at the time.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know. I guess it's... I guess it could go either way.
I guess, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I guess we just assume that everybody knows who Freddy is if they live in Springwood. Is that just our...
I would think so, given how many people he killed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, 22 kids? 21 kids?
Oh, is that the number before he died?
Yeah, I thought it was 21 kids before he died.
Oh.
Or, yeah, he killed 21 kids before he died. I always assumed that the bodies hanging in the beginning of Nightmare 3 when Kristen walks, when she's dreaming and she's carrying the little charred girl that burnt, when she walks into that room where all the bodies are hanging by a noose or whatever, I just assumed those were the 21 kids that he killed before he was burned alive.
Mm-hmm.
Why I have that in my head, I probably read a book or something in, like, in the 90s that explained that, and it's just been canon ever since to me, but I could be completely wrong.
It's a reasonable thing to assume.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's like when you just believe something for so long, you just consider it fact, and, like, everybody else knows it as well. So, 21 kids for some reason. That just sounds like how many kids he's supposedly killed.
Mm-hmm.
Beforehand.
In the first one, Ronnie Blakely says he killed at least 20 kids we all knew.
Okay, so that's where that came from. Okay. Yeah. Sometimes my nightmare knowledge gets a little fuzzy because I've had it for so long, but yet am not keeping up to date on it because I'm an adult now and I have to use my brain space for adult things. So, yeah.
Well, I feel like I've watched it so much when I was younger that, like, that those movies are really, like, locked in and I know the details really well. But now when I watch something now, like, if I'm watching a TV show week to week, like, but when I'll sit down to watch a show and be like, I don't remember at all what happened last week. Like,
Yeah. I'll do that too. Yeah. Because I watched it so many times as a kid. It's just, you know, secondhand knowledge to me. It's just, but I'll watch something now and I'll be like, wait, what happened last week? I don't remember, whatever. Oh, this guy got killed, okay. Whatever.
Or people will say, like, have you seen this movie? And I'll be like, I know I have, but I literally cannot remember anything about it.
And maybe that goes to say something about the quality of the writing or the quality of the movies that we have these days, that they're just not worth remembering. Or we just had so much brain space in our head when we were a teenager that we had to fill it with something. So why not Freddy knowledge?
Exactly.
Let's just fill it with Freddy history.
Gotta know about something.
Yeah. So, and you are the Freddy expert. So.
Oh, you're a Freddy expert as well.
No, you were on the TV show or you were on Experts.
Yes.
So yeah, you are the Freddy expert.
Well, thank you.
I just gave you that title.
All right. Well, thank you.
You can put it on your resume and see how far that gets you. Okay. So what did you think of the overall plot as it moved forward?
I mean, I thought the Brian stuff was solid story-wise. But there wasn't I mean, I like Lar Park-Lincoln, but her half of the story, and I mean, I enjoyed the parts of it. I thought the crazy nurse was fun, but there's really not much story there except the I don't even know if you would call it a twist, but with her parents at the end.
I had the exact feeling where I just felt like they were making it up as they went along, the whole script. Like, they didn't even have a script that was written. They just showed up to set that day, and they were like, what do you want to film?
Right.
Like, hey, it would kind of be cool if her parents were dead and they disappeared. Great, let's do that. So, yeah, I didn't understand why they didn't go into the backstory of her parents. I think that was a missed opportunity with the whole plot, that maybe that biker guy killed her parents as well, and he was like on parole or something, or he broke out of jail.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so that kind of, that could have like tied the whole biker guy into it, because as for the episode, he was just some random guy that, you know, was like, well, it's 3 o'clock in the morning, I'll just kill a few teenagers and go about my day.
Right. Yeah, that would have been a good tie-in. Or, and also the contrast between, like, you know, she's on her own, you know, being Dylan McKay without parents.
Yes.
He's the opposite. He's got, you know, overbearing parents who want to plan out his life for him.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So maybe that was the attraction between those two, that they were such yin and yang, their relationship, that, yeah, that's what progressed them forward, because maybe she wanted overbearing parents because she didn't have them. And maybe he didn't want parents at all because he had such controlling parents.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, I think that ties back in with reaching out to these adolescent problems to try to, you know, reach out to the target demographic and, you know, have that with them.
Yeah.
Kind of have that that relatable storyline for them. I don't know.
And I loved that there was this cast of people who had been in other horror movies. So we talked about Lar Park-Lincoln being from Friday the 13th Part 7, but also the nurse was Nancy McLoughlin, who was killed by Jason in Friday the 13th Part 6. And also her husband, Tom McLoughlin, directed this episode and also directed Friday the 13th Part 6. And then also we have Bird DeBenning, who played the doctor in this and also played Dan's dad in Nightmare on Elm Street 5. So apart from Robert Ing.
This is why you are the nightmare expert. Because, like, I knew that Lar was in Friday the 13th, but I didn't know anything about Toby Hooper or his wife. I didn't
think
that that was...
Yeah, Toby Hooper was the last episode.
Yes. I'm sorry. No, see, this is why I'm not the expert. Yeah. Okay. So, yeah. So I did not pick up on that at all. And I did not recognize Dan's dad as the nurse. Not even a little bit. Mm-hmm. And I'm kind of ashamed of that. I feel like I should have picked up on that. Well, but he didn't.
I guess he doesn't have a big part in Nightmare 5, but...
Still, yeah. I mean, I've watched that movie more times than I could count, but I'm pretty good at picking out actors. Like, oh, he was the guy who stood up during the trial and yelled, "You're wrong," and then sat back down. Right. You know, from so yeah, I mean, I used to be good at it, but I'm old now, and my brain just isn't what it used to be.
And this was probably shot with like this. Episode and Nightmare 5 were probably within the same year, filmed within the same year as each other.
Yeah, and I looked up because I was curious to see what happened first. Friday the 13th Part 7 came out May 13th, 1988, and this episode came out October 16th, 1988. So viewers knew Karen as a Friday the 13th after, before they knew her as a Freddy's Nightmare. So
nice.
I wonder, I wasn't big into Friday the 13th in the 80s or 90s. So I wouldn't have considered that a terrible, terrible sin to jump ship and go from Friday the 13th or go to Nightmare on Elm Street from Friday the 13th, even though, you know, it's Freddy's Nightmares, not canon, but You know, like, how do you think fans felt about that? Were they betrayed at all? Like, what happened?
I mean, I can't speak for anyone else, but I wouldn't think of it as a betrayal. It's like, you know, I was just, you know, someone we liked in this, you know, this horror movie that we saw in May. You know, she was the main character, and now she's on a Freddy TV show. I would be excited about it.
See, I would take it as the exact opposite, because when I am loyal to a brand, like, mm-hmm. that is it. I will die for that brand. But if I was big into Friday the 13th, I would see it as like, how dare you?
So you wouldn't have...
Leave Friday the 13th, yeah.
So if Heather Langenkamp had done an episode of Friday the 13th, the series, you would have been against that?
Well, let me preface this with Heather Langenkamp can do no wrong. Right. Okay, so I'll just preface it with that. So... No, I wouldn't be mad, because I would be so excited to see her in something. I would just forgive her completely. Oh. However, if Patricia Arquette went from Nightmare 3 to a Friday the 13th episode, I would have ill feelings about that. And I would say, hey, Patricia, what are you doing?
Just call her up.
I would call her up and I would say, look, I understand we all need a paycheck. However, there is loyalty in Hollywood and you need to follow it. And then she would hang up on me and probably get a restraining order.
Also,
that's fine.
Not in the case of Patricia Arquette these days, but, you know, they're actors. They've got to work. You know, you take what's offered to you.
I guess. But, you know, when this aired, I was 9 years old, so I didn't understand what a paycheck meant, you know.
And then she got to do, Lar Park Lincoln got to do Matt's Landing she was on it for a few years after this. So she had a good run acting wise in the late 80s, early 90s.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So how did you feel about this episode overall?
I mean, if I were a television critic, you know, it's not, it's definitely flawed, but I enjoyed watching it. I enjoyed the characters, and even like the second half where story wise, it didn't really make much sense. I just sort of enjoyed like the crazy nurse and the weird imagery. I thought it was a good time. What did you think of it?
I really had to force myself to get through this episode. I did not like it one bit. There were some redeeming qualities that I liked from a writer's point of view. Mm-hmm. That whole adolescent problem that I keep going back to. I think because that's the only thing that I really liked about it. I liked the foreshadowing of I'll probably die here, that bit of dialogue at the beginning. But I think that there were just so many missed opportunities, and that overshadows any of the good qualities that I liked about this episode. The whole, like, they should have made it Craven, and maybe they couldn't do it because of the rights and stuff. So that's kind of forgivable. Mm-hmm. But I just thought there were a lot of missed opportunities. There were a lot of plot holes for no reason. And I wrote down in my notes that the quality was worse than Are You Afraid of the Dark? I guess that's how I felt about it. But I really liked Are You Afraid of the Dark when I was a kid.
Oh, okay. I saw it here and there, but I wasn't a regular viewer of it.
Oh, yeah. I was a big fan of, I think, like, especially the first 3 years when, do you remember Snick?
Oh, of course,
on Nickelodeon, it was... Saturday Night Nickelodeon. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Are You Afraid of the Dark was during that lineup. And I loved it. Like, my Saturday nights were set. My friends, you know, would be like, hey, do you want to stay the night? And I'd say, well, do you get Nickelodeon? that would base on whether or not I would go over to their house.
That's great. I have a good friend who loves Roundhouse. And so I would watch that with her in high school. That was part of the SNCC lineup.
Okay, I don't remember that show.
It was like a sketch comedy show.
I remember All That. That was a sketch comedy show.
That was Amanda Bynes later. In it. Yeah. Like
okay.
It was Roundhouse. Was the whole thing was sort of taped live in front of a studio audience, and they'd sort of run around the set and do little sketches here and there.
No, I don't remember that at all. What else was a part of SNCC? Like Rugrats? Was that or was that?
Was Clarissa Explains It All? Was that SNCC?
Maybe. That sounds familiar. Yeah. Okay. I'm just going to say yes. It's it might not be right, but I'm just going to say yes, because in my heart, that feels mm-hmm. right. And sometimes you just got to go with your heart. Right. So calling it, yes, Clarissa was part of SNCC. Excellent. So, okay. Excellent. Yeah. What would you rate this episode if you were on IMDb right now on a scale of 1 to 10? What would you give it?
I mean, I would, if the scale were for like Freddy's Nightmares episode, I would, Freddy's Nightmares episode, I would rate it higher. But if okay. it's like a scale of everything in the world, then probably a 3 or 4, maybe.
Okay. Everything in the world. That's, yeah, that's really hard to compare it to. On IMDb, it has an average rating of 5.6 based off 98 people rating it. 5.6 out of 10.
People are nicer than I am, I guess. What would you give it?
I would definitely not give it a 5.6. Mm-hmm. Yeah, these people are definitely way nicer than I am. I would give it about a 3, 3.5. Mm-hmm. I was just severely disappointed with this episode. And if I was a kid in the 80s watching this, I don't know if I would continue to watch it, because it was such a huge letdown that Freddy had such a microscopic part in it and I wasn't prepared for it. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe if in the TV guide they gave a disclaimer, don't get your hopes up, kid.
Right. Because Freddy's barely
he's
in it.
He's not in this yeah. episode. Yeah, it might have been okay. But no, that I think that was a really crappy move on their part. Mm-hmm. That whole like bait and switch. And it just, yeah, wasn't cool.
Right. And I actually wrote in my notes like that it was lacking a fun quip at the end. He says, at the end of the episode, he comes on screen and says, "Remember, we made house calls," and then walks away.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's funny.
It's like, what is
because
that?
Because in... Go ahead.
What does that even mean? Like, that's not...
yeah.
It's not a fun, quirky thing.
Yeah. That's funny, because in my notes, I also wrote that it seemed like Robert Englund just had to introduce the show, give a one-liner, and he was done. Mm-hmm. And it reminds me of a Simpsons episode where Krusty the Clown is recording like his greatest hits or something. And he walks into the recording studio because he's done it so many times, mm-hmm. you know. He walks into the recording studio, gives his like 10 one-liners and walks out. And he does it so quickly that the person recording it didn't even have time to like fetch a new tape or whatever to record it. And so he's like, "Okay, Krusty, we're ready." And Krusty's like gone, because it's just wham, bam, I'm done. So yeah. And that's what it felt like. That's what Robert Englund had to do. Like, okay, we have Robert and Freddie makeup for one day. Mm. We're going to film him saying 22 different one-liners, exactly. one for each episode, and then get him out of here. Let's keep it going. So that's how I feel about it. I was not impressed with this episode.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely wasn't fantastic.
Mm-mm. Okay, well, on that note, join us next week. Do you have anything for next week's episode?
Well, thank you so much for joining us for our second episode, season 1, episode 2 of Freddy's Nightmares. Please join us next week when we will be talking about season 1, episode 3, Killer Instinct, in which actress Lori Petty tries to get ahead of her track competition.